On behalf of the Nakamaru family, I want to thank you for taking the time to join us here today as we celebrate the life of a special young lady, Lisa Sayaka Nakamaru. I know there's a lot of hurt and pain, and there are a ton of tears and mourning for the loss of such a beautiful person. And that's okay. Lisa's death was shocking and devastating. Many hearts and lives have been shattered. And I know it's been especially painful for her grandmother Lillian Nakamaru, her grandfather Yukio Tanaka, her parents Ward and Grace, her older brothers Calvin and Andy, her boyfriend Alan, and her beloved lab Rosie, as well as her many uncles and aunties. Now, I don't have the answers to why such an amazing person's life would be cut so short, but I do know that we can find comfort in God today, because I know God loved Lisa, and God loves each and every one of you, and he wants to help comfort you and help you grieve through this time, because he understands what it's like to lose a child. Jesus Christ was God's one and only son, and he was killed at a very young age. So with God's help, let's grieve and mourn Lisa's passing. But let's also reflect and learn from Lisa's remarkable life. Lisa's life began on December 8th, 1993. She attended an international bilingual school, a Japanese immersion school in Palos Verdes, until the second grade. There she learned to speak Japanese, her mother's first language. At a very young age, she grew up bilingual. And after building a strong foundation, she went on to Arnold Elementary School, then to Cali Mayor Middle School, and then to South High School. She was always a very active student, but Lisa really flourished at South High, where she joined the Associated Student Body. After graduating South High, she attended UC Davis and was majoring in human development. This year was the start of her junior year. Sports and outdoor activities were a huge passion in Lisa's life. She enjoyed competing on the UC Davis Ultimate Frisbee team, and her spirit of adventure led to a love of snowboarding, hiking, and camping. She had a bucket list to travel every continent, and this past summer, she checked off one of those continents by embarking on a family trip to Africa. Lisa always seemed to be smiling, and boy, could she smile. But Lisa also seemed to bring a smile to everyone she met. I never had the privilege to meet Lisa, but after reading all the posts on her memorial page on Facebook and meeting and talking with her family and loved ones, her life's testimony brought another smile to this face. Lisa was beautiful, strong, fearless, selfless, generous, joyful, and loving. Her life inspires so many, including me, to be like her. The Bible says in Ecclesiastes 3, there is a time for everything and a season for every activity under the heavens, including a time to weep, but also a time to laugh, a time to mourn, but also a time to dance. Today, I know there will be a lot of weeping and mourning for the loss of Lisa. But I can't think of a better way to honor Lisa than by also making this a time of laughing and smiling, as we also make this a time to celebrate and rejoice the life of Lisa. So today, through our grief and pain, let's also laugh and smile as we reflect and learn to be like Lisa, laugh like Lisa, love like Lisa, and live like Lisa. Would you join me in a word of prayer? Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, words can't express the emotions and thoughts we have right now. But we know you love Lisa, and you know how much she was loved by everyone that met her. Today, would you help comfort us as we time to reflect and celebrate Lisa's life? Would you especially minister to her family, as you know what it was like to experience loss when your son Jesus Christ died on the cross for us? So please help us grieve and mourn today. God, thank you for Lisa's life. We're all better for having known her. Help us to celebrate the remarkable life of Lisa, and may we learn to love and live like her. Pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good afternoon. I'm Steven. I'm one of Lisa's Calabash cousins. None of you know what that means. A lot of you know what Ohana means, though. Family, that's a word that you're going to hear a few times today. Whether immediate, extended, a friend, it didn't matter. Whenever Lisa hit you with that smile, that unforgettable smile, she made you feel like Ohana. We're going to start with some reflections. Sian.
For years, I have written countless birthday cards, yearbook entries, and Facebook posts filled with an outpouring of my love and admiration for Lisa. Lisa has always meant the world to me, and I made sure to constantly remind her of it. But writing this reflection of our time together is one of the hardest things I've ever done. This past week, there's something I've realized. I'm the lucky one, the one who is lucky enough to meet a vivacious second grader back on the playground 12 years ago. And eventually attend college with her. I was lucky enough to be part of a long, beautiful friendship filled with constant laughter and love. I was lucky enough to have my life touched and changed by a one-of-a-kind individual. I was lucky enough to be best friends and sisters with Lisa Nakamaru, and in all honesty, I think that makes me one of the luckiest girls in the world. Lisa and I had a rare friendship, a friendship most people don't get the opportunity to experience. When Lisa and I became friends, we were no longer just Sian or just Lisa. We were known as a single unit, Sian and Lisa. As kids, my mom used to call Lisa to ask where I was because inevitably, I was always with her. She became my other half, my sister, and the only person in my life who I knew was and would always be there. From taking baths together as children to sharing bunk beds in college, she remained by my side to catch me if I fell and support me through whatever life decided to throw away. We grew and learned from each other, pushed each other's boundaries, and tested our limits. We forced each other to try new things and become better people. In our 12 years of friendship, Lisa changed my world. She supported me, loved me, and taught me more than she'll ever know. She brought out the best in me, and for that, I'm eternally grateful. Lisa lived her life in a spectacular way, and there are countless life lessons I've learned from her in our years together. I know these will be a constant reminder for me to live like Lisa. First off, Lisa taught me to take risks. This is one of the most valuable things I've learned from Lisa. Whether it was eating new foods, talking to strangers, or trying new things, Lisa gave me the courage to take risks. Lisa and I went on countless trips together over the years, and most of them tested my limits and pushed me way out of my comfort zone. However, one of our most memorable trips together, Lisa even got me to surf, snorkel, and cliff jump when I really didn't know how to swim. However, one of our most memorable trips together was our hike up Half Dome, when she asked me to take on one of the world's toughest hikes with her. I was honestly terrified, especially because I'm ridiculously clumsy and have zero athletic ability, but she encouraged me and assured me that I could do it. Hiking Half Dome ended up being one of the most rewarding things I've ever done, and I would have never thought of doing it without Lisa's push for me to take the risk. Don't be afraid to be yourself. Lisa not only put up with my crazy weird antics, but she embraced it and joined me in the craziness. She encouraged everyone to embrace our true selves and to not be afraid of what people thought. Lisa and I proudly walked in public in our favorite onesies, reenacted scenes from our favorite TV shows, The Regular Show and Bob's Burgers, and sang our hearts out on long road trips to and from school. She always encouraged me to spend time by myself and to be fearless in making decisions that benefited only me and not anyone else. Around her, I never felt pressured to be anyone but myself. Dance your heart out. A lot of people probably don't know this about Lisa, but she really liked to dance. Not professionally or anything, but Lisa never missed an opportunity to bust a move. When Lisa and I were in fifth grade, we decided to enter our elementary school talent show. We performed a dance number to Kids in America, receiving a standing ovation from the audience. Despite our lack of talent, Lisa and I continued to choreograph dances up until our freshman year of college, including our own renditions of Thriller, You've Got a Friend in Me, and Salt-N-Pepa's Push It. Congrats to the lucky few that got to witness the magic of our choreographed dance moves in person. Practice patience. This was especially important for Lisa because she had to deal with my high-strung tendencies all these years. Totally kidding, but in all seriousness, Lisa is the most patient person I've ever met. When it came to babysitting, routing kids, dealing with stressful situations at home or at school, she always kept her cool. Lisa was the perfect balance for me when it came to being ASU president and vice president together in high school, and I don't think I could have ever gotten through that year without her. She taught me to realize what's truly important in life and to stay grounded even when things got tough. Family always comes first. Lisa always put her family first. I could go on forever about the instances that provided this, but to name a few, she spent countless weekends helping her mom with chores around the house, caring for her grandma, gardening with Ojichon, and taking Rosie, her favorite family member, for a swim. Every year, Lisa absolutely could not wait for Memorial Day weekend to arrive because it meant she would get to spend the entire weekend with her family in her favorite place, Mammoth. In Mammoth, Lisa was in her element, and I was lucky enough to experience this family trip with her a couple times. Last year, Lisa noticed that her family hadn't gone on a vacation in a while, so she decided to get a job and work gruesome hours at a local grocery store so she could save up the money to buy her family a trip to Alaska on an Alaskan cruise. She wanted to give her family the opportunity to travel for all they had given her. Laugh and be goofy. There is never a moment Lisa and I weren't laughing to the point of tears. Her wild, carefree spirit led to constant laughter and ridiculous moments. Even through life's challenges, we were able to laugh at ourselves and our mistakes. The hours spent laughing with Lisa will always be in my heart and will be a constant reminder to not take life too seriously. Most importantly, be present in all things and thankful for all things. Lisa's daily mission in life was to live with passion, compassion, and humor. She lived every day purposefully. Living with her for a year, I saw this firsthand. Whether she was having a Skype date with Alan, spending time with old friends, or adventuring with her Frisbee team, Lisa spent every day doing something she loved or spending time with someone she loved. The constant ache I felt in my heart since I heard the news last week has been absolutely unbearable because Lisa meant more than the world to me. Even now, it doesn't seem like she's gone. I think this is because she is very much alive in my thoughts and memories. Every moment, laugh, adventure, struggle, and success I got to share with my best friend, my partner in crime, and my person gives me the strength to carry on. It's comforting to know Lisa did more in her 20 years than most do in a lifetime. She traveled the world, she fell in love, she impacted countless lives and found happiness every day. I love my sunset chasing, adventure seeking, freestyle rapping, and constantly dancing best friend. And she will always be in my heart. I love you, Lisa.
Dana.
Hi guys, my name is Dana, and Lisa Nakamaru is my best friend. I met Lisa playing volleyball my freshman year at South, and I'm pretty sure what happened was one day at practice I made a stupid joke, and Lisa was the only one that found it funny. I knew then that she was a keeper. We grew close throughout the season, and by the end of it, I considered her my best friend. I had never met someone so openly weird as Lisa in a time when everyone was trying not to be. It was refreshing and inspiring to see someone so unbelievably comfortable in their own skin. And she definitely brought out the weirdo in me. Oftentimes, Lisa would come over, and it wasn't long before my family adored her as much as I did. My mom would pull up to the house and see the little white gallant parked outside, and she would come through the door grinning and excited to see Lisa. My sister would come out and sit with me while Lisa was sprawled out on our living room floor, which quickly became her designated spot. Even my dad would pause whatever sports event he was watching to come say hello. The, The only person who wasn't excited to see Lisa was my cat. And that was because Lisa insisted on petting her with her bare feet. After Lisa would leave throughout the rest of the day, randomly throughout the house, you would hear one of us say, "I love Lisa." Because even though she had left, she's continued to brighten our day. Lisa was a part of our family, and I consider myself so unbelievably lucky to be able to say that. Later on in high school, Lisa inspired me to join ASB, and we worked together in the athletic training room. Seeing her contagious smile was a consistent part of my daily routine, and almost all of my high school experiences were spent behind her. Whether procrastinating on summer school homework, doing crafts, or going on spontaneous adventures, my best memories are the ones I have with her. Over all those years, Lisa has shaped me and made me a better person in ways that I've never realized. I always admired how selfless she was, and she was constantly going out of her way to help others. Whether it was giving someone a ride or bringing me ice cream because I had a bad day, she was always thinking of others, and she is easily the most considerate person I know. To this day, I still catch myself thinking, what would Lisa do? Whether it's a friend that's hurting or that needs a favor, that thought runs through my head, and I'm such a better person because of it, because of her. 2 years ago, Lisa and I found ourselves complaining about the litter left on the beach on 4th of July, and we decided to clean some of it up. We quickly filled every trash can in our area, and the following year, we came more prepared. Armed with trash bags and gloves, we went to work, and we decided that this would be a yearly tradition, a tradition that I have every intention of keeping alive. She is constantly working to make the world a better place. She was the most intrinsically happy person that I have ever met, and that is such an amazing thing because some people will go their entire lives and not find that kind of happiness. In my senior yearbook, Lisa, after addressing it, Dana PP Face Poss, wrote, We just knew it's not quite the right time to grow up, and I appreciate that. Our childish actions will forever be remembered. And that's what we were when we were together, just kids having fun, not worrying about other things, goofing off and enjoying each other's company. And that will forever be remembered. I love you, Lisa.
Sarah.
Lisa and I became best friends in Miss Maisie's third grade class. We were young and silly back then. We were dorks and we ate pork with our forks. Over the years, my main group of friends changed, but Lisa was always my constant. No matter what, she was always there to stick a lunch bucket on her head with me and walk around SeaWorld or spend hours trying to perfect our rock star music video. And in years later, to navigate the journey that was high school. Gossiping about boys, studying for tests together, or just hanging around and watching hours of Big Cat documentaries. Lisa had a beautiful outlook on life. She had a joy within her that everyone who met her could sense. She was happy, and she wanted you to be happy too. Once you knew her, you were sure to be greeted with a smile and a hug. Our classmates, our teachers, and our families were all charmed by her. I don't know how she did it, but she formed a special bond with everyone she met. And my family members were no exception. She and my mom always had something to talk about. And every time we came home for breaks during college, she would demand to have at least one meal with my grandma. She always made the guest list for my younger sister's birthday parties, sometimes even before I did. And although Lisa only met my cousin once in person, she considered her a friend and asked about her often. She even sent me with a gift for my cousin's birthday this year, along with encouraging words about being a freshman in college. Lisa's heart was so big, something you could tell within minutes of meeting her. She touched so many lives, and I know that she'll continue to touch our hearts as long as we keep them open to her. I work every day to live like Lisa. As my best friend, she was there not only to support and encourage me, but also to inspire me, to be more adventurous, to put myself out there and trust the people around me, to have confidence and be the person who I want to be kind and considerate. I could go on and on about the things I hope to take from knowing her. It would be impossible to put into words. Thankful I am to have had Lisa in my life as long as I did.
And I refuse to look back on our friendship with anything but happiness. I am truly blessed, and I know she was a blessing to many more. And although it hurts that our friendship won't be continuing on in a conventional manner, I know it will continue in a special way. She will continue to guide me through the various obstacles of life, and I know that when I need her the most, she will always be there with me in my heart and in my mind. Lisa Nakamaru is the type of person who is impossible to forget, and I don't plan on forgetting a single thing. Lisa was and always will be my best friend.
If Lauren, Michelle, and Maddie want to come up, please. They prepared a reflection, but they've asked me to read it, but I want them to be on stage. When the name Lisa comes to mind, so many different memories come up. Being her roommates, we experienced Lisa full throttle with her smile that never quit and her go-get-em attitude. We saw her when she was at her best and when she was at her worst. And even at her worst, she was still the strongest and most positive being. Anyone that has had the privilege of interacting with Lisa, whether it was just for a brief moment or for many years, could see her kind nature radiating from her smile. She would do anything for anyone if she could. She was that selfless. Even people that barely knew her could see that. Being able to live with her allowed us to see parts of her that she shared only with her closest friends. She was a riot. The most random things could spur her crazy antics, which involved late night dancing, serenading, and all around shenanigans. These memories seemed so mundane back then, but now these are the memories that we will cherish the most. One of our finest memories of her was from our trip to the East Coast. Her adventurous spirit truly shined during this time. 24 hours in a day were just not enough time for her to see everything she wanted to see and do everything that she wanted to do. She served as our tour guide, our motivator, and our companion. She was there to lead us into the unknown in a city that she had never been to herself. She was there to keep us going when our feet were protesting from extreme cold that as California girls were just not used to. She was there, California girls. She was there to share those great memories with us. One of these said memories is the five of us trying to catch the train from New York back to Philadelphia. Being as directionally challenged as we are, Lisa was the one who stepped up and led us all back to the train station. She led us running through Madison Square Garden in the snow, and even though she took a tumble, she didn't hesitate to pick herself back up and keep going. This was the kind of person that she was. She never let any obstacles stop her from reaching her goals. And this translated into her school life, too. She took her studies seriously and never took anything for granted. She spent countless nights during finals week holed up in the library and in her room. We will never forget the Panera study dates and the late night Dutch Bros coffee runs. And when the going got hard, she would always suggest mental health breaks that involved planting flowers, going shopping. She was always looking out for us and leaving us little surprises here and there when she knew we had a rough day. These memories only begin to scratch the surface who Lisa was and what she meant to us. She was the most kind-hearted, thoughtful, and free-spirited girl. We are so blessed to have gotten to spend the time with her that she had so graciously given us. Although our time with her was cut short, she gave us memories that will last a lifetime. We love you, Lisa. Next, we'll have a floral tribute. And we'll start with her early childhood, Genasano, and now Shiota. Next, from their International Bilingual School, Lisa Miyamoto and Yume Nishi. Representing Lisa's ASB and South High days, Vicky Hildreth and Jane Hirayama. Some of Lisa's friends from South, Devin De Los Reyes, Caitlin Ofsenko, Ali Mochizuki, and Deanna Sun. Some of Lisa's fellow members of the UC Davis Ultimate Frisbee team, Emily Wilson, Olivia Hart, Kelsey Clausen.
It's my honor today to be playing a song I wrote called Backbite On, in honor of Lisa.
Bundle of my dear.
These words were prepared by my sister, Kimmy. I would like to share one story with you, a story that I believe is a true testament to the incredible person and friend Lisa was. But before I do that, I want to share a few words about my personal relationship with Lisa. For those of you who don't know, Lisa's and my mom have been very close since they were young. Their friendship brought Lisa and I together in a way that made us like family. I found a lifelong friend in Lisa, and she and I seemed to understand and appreciate each other in a way that no one else really could. The time that we shared together was always filled with laughter, so much laughter that it often led to tears. She had the ability to bring out the little kid in me, which is something that I believe is extremely important no matter how old we get. When we were little, our moms enrolled us in summer camps by my house in Huntington Beach. And even though the camps themselves were sometimes awful, it didn't seem to matter because it meant that we got to spend the entire week together. It was any two young best friends' dream. One summer, we participated in a beach volleyball camp, Junior Spikers. My neighbors who lived across the street also attended the same camp, and I introduced them to Lisa. That was the only time that she met them. And keep in mind, we were probably in fifth or sixth grade. But even as years passed and we got older, Lisa would always make it a point to ask me nearly every time we saw one another, "Hey, Kimbo, Kimbo Slice, how are Chad and Colin doing? Tell them I say hi." I think we can all humbly admit that most of us would forget to do the same. But this was just a reflection of Lisa's character. She was a genuine friend who truly loved people, even if she just met them and knew them for only a brief time. Lisa radiated kindness and happiness, and she was and will continue to be such a positive light in our lives.
I'm deeply comforted by the fact that we can all honor her joyful spirit and keep her legacy alive and thriving. When I learned of her passing, I was inspired to do something. In remembrance of Lisa, as I look around, I see that many of you are wearing these purple wristbands, purple for her favorite color, and they're printed with the words, "Live like Lisa." I never got the chance to tell Lisa what a profound impact she has made in my life, but I hope we can all make her proud as we try to live more like she did, with a loving spirit, without fear, spreading kindness and seizing each and every moment. While I know this goodbye has come too soon, I am forever grateful to have found a forever friend. I love you, Lisa.
Lisa had a beautiful and effortless way of impacting the lives of everyone that she came in contact with. I was immediately drawn in by her perfect smile. It was a smile that assured me that she already loved me, even if we had just met. Beyond her big grin, her hugs were equally amazing. She hugged me in a way that made me feel like she hadn't seen me in forever. During these 3.5 years, Lisa completed what I've been missing in my life. Being surrounded around her family, I began to realize that I wasn't raised in the same ways that she was, a big family filled with so much laughter and bickering. When I shared this with Lisa, she was so devastated, yet so eager to share with me her whole life. It was the little things that meant the most, like when I told her my tragic story of losing my first balloon, and she brought me a dozen balloons the next day to school. I still remember it like yesterday. I carried the balloons around all day, feeling like a kid should feel on his birthday. She brought me so many little joys like that. She taught me how to snowboard. She taught me how to fly kite. She brought me along to her favorite places like Mammoth. She took me to my first baseball game. She bought me my first stuffed animal. She even sewed me my first baby blankie because I never had one. She gave me my whole childhood back. As we grew together, our personalities changed. We had our differences, but I always admired her positive vision on life. Now that she had given me my childhood, I couldn't wait to be older and get out into the real world. I was eager to be in the future. Lisa was different, though. If given the choice, she would be a kid forever. Watching Disney movies and taking long naps would have been the life. She lived in the moment and did what she loved. She always told me, "The future isn't anything people plan, and everything far away from this moment isn't worth thinking about." Sure, she was worried about the future, but she never let the unknown consume her worries. She only planned to have the best day today. She lived this motto every single day, and I admired that about her so much. Because of her love for life, she always hated seeing people sad. She knew exactly how to cheer up people, especially myself. I was so lucky to have known someone who knew what to do every single time I felt sad. She had a quirky and funny way of making people happy. She loved playing slow love songs, where she could do interpretive dance choreographies. I won't forget how her eyes widened as she emphasized the words, her knees bruising after she falls down and tumbles, and her face constantly changing expressions to fit the lyrics. Lisa brought everyone laughter and joy. It was as if all she needed for herself to be happy was to see us happy. I always wanted to give her the best things in life, but she always told me that she didn't need it. 2 weeks ago, I told her that we should go on a date anywhere she likes because we haven't been on one since I moved to Davis. Hoping to treat her somewhere nice, I was surprised when she wanted to take out sushi from Safeway. I saw her completely satisfied as she ate her trashy bowl, sprawled out on the couch, laughing at the TV. I also used to buy her roses, but she eventually admitted that she preferred daisies and sunflowers. I assured myself that she only told me this to save myself some money, but in time I realized that she really loved these flowers. She had a genuine way of finding the beauty in the simple things of life. Beyond these qualities, I admired how Lisa saw so much honesty in people, myself included. One of the favorite moments I had with Lisa was the day I convinced her that I was the Prince of China. I asked her to be my princess, and she accepted immediately. She told me, "I always knew you were special, and now you're a prince." I felt pretty terrible that she thought that I was serious, and that she thought that I was noble enough to be her prince. But she was like that. She always believed in you. From that day on, I tried my best to treat her as my princess. For someone so small and kind, Lisa was the most fearless person that I knew. This summer, we decided to go skydiving. I remember looking right at her as we were going to jump. She had such a stern face full of determination. I was hoping that I could reassure her, but it was her who reassured me of living life on the edge. Even when she was younger, she was always the most fearless one. She was the first to jump off the highest cliffs in Hawaii. She was the first to hold her friends' hands when they were scared. I feel that the only fear she ever felt in life was not living it. My favorite quality that I was always treasure about Lisa is how she was the best friend to everyone. She always assured me that I was only hers, but deep down, I knew that I needed to share her with the world. People needed Lisa, and I was proud of sharing her kind soul with them. I wish she had given more time to herself, but that was her. She found so much joy and happiness in being a good friend. I will miss everything about her, but I know that she'll always be with me, in my habits, in my mind, and in my heart. I'll forever be trying to live like Lisa, kicking my feet up on the dashboard, screaming at the TV when the Giants score, singing all of the high notes and songs, watching Disney movies and napping, drawing my favorite animals in my notebook, dancing as if I was alone, and smiling at even my lowest lows, because I know she would be. To my everything, Our love was perfect, not because we didn't have any flaws, but because we loved, accepted, and supported each other. It was an amazing adventure that will never be forgotten. To my princess of China, my koala bear, and my star, I love you.
Growing up with Lisa has been an incredible experience. A relationship so close that people confuse us as being twins. Of course, we're not actually twins, but the idea of it seemed to be a constant source of laughter. I'll always remember first day of high school. My dad pulled me to the side and said, "Take care of your sister." I nodded as if it was my life's mission. I was kind of the inside eyes for my dad. You see, Calvin and I never got a chance to go to high school together, so I never really had an idea of what it would be like. I mostly remember being very overprotective of her, just like an older brother should be. Seeing her in the halls, talking to some boy, I didn't care if you were good or bad, I already didn't like you. The thing is, she had more than two older brothers. My friends played a big part in scaring them off as well. "Fall back," I yelled from the other end of the hall. I only did this because I was saving her for someone that deserved her, like Alan, obviously. She has taught me so many valuable lessons throughout the years. She inspired me to explore the beautiful views Oahu has to offer, get better grades in school, take better care of the world, and respect others. One thing I've noticed about her is that she always made an effort to bond with people. It might have been a hobby or place that she had no interest in, but she would do it anyways because she wanted to support you. So for the past couple months, I have been secretly watching Disney movies online. This includes her favorites such as Hercules, Lion King, and Lilo and Stitch. She seemed to really enjoy these pop quizzes I gave her about these irrelevant characters in these movies. Every time she got these questions right, I replied with a reaction of utter disbelief. Like, how many people actually know the name of the giant seagull and the Little Mermaid? That's a $1 million question. I'm sure only the true Disney fans know the answer. As I watched Lilo and Stitch, I couldn't help but think they matched our relationship. She reminded me so much of Lilo, sweet, caring, creative, and adventurous. While I was the obnoxious, crazy, yet still loving Stitch, Ohana means family, the movie says. Family means nobody gets left behind or forgotten. Now I think back to what my dad told me, look out for your sister. But now the roles will be reversed. She will be looking out for me from heaven. Thank you for everything you've done for me, Lisa. I love you so much.
Hi, I'm Calvin, Lisa's oldest brother. Thank you all for coming today. I'm pretty sure you all know Lisa, but for those who don't know her too well, she was the sweetest and most caring little sister I could ask for. When she was in town a couple weeks ago, Lisa planned a camping trip with my dad, Alan, and Janet. Because we had so much camping equipment, there was only one spot left in the car. came down to her beloved dog, Rosie, and me. And to no surprise, she looked at me and said, "Sorry, Calvin, you're voted off the island." Rosie meant the world to her. Even our last exchange was about Rosie. She told me, "Thank you for walking her," as I responded with a brief, "No problem." I didn't think much about this until now, but my little sister has so much love in her heart. Whether it was for her family, friends, or her dog Rosie, she always put everyone else before herself. Even though she voted me off the island first, I always admired her compassion in life. During these past 2 years, we weren't able to talk as much because she was a devoted and determined college student, and I was working full-time. Our times together were limited, but we got along very well because of our shared love for adventure. My best memories with my sister were times we went snowboarding. Every year, we would take a family trip with friends to Mammoth, and although this was the only vacation she had, she would always take the time to teach her friends how to snowboard. She could have boarded down the most advanced slopes or practiced her tricks in the snow park, but she would be more than happy to ride down the bunny slopes with a friend. After a couple of runs and eating lunch, everyone would be too exhausted to get back on the slopes. But it was Lisa who would always agree to board down Cornice, the highest point in Mammoth, with her older brothers. I tried to teach her everything I knew because she was always open to learn new tricks. I would always film her so she can watch it over and over on her phone later. We usually snowboarded until the sun went down or until we couldn't feel our legs. These are the bonding moments with her that I will cherish forever. Snowboarding will never be the same without Lisa, but I know she would be so disappointed if I stopped going. Every time I go to the highest point of the mountain, I will know that she'll be there right next to me, smiling, determined, and ready. Every time I ride down the mountain, it will be for you. Thank you for the great times, Lisa. I love you very much. See you at the top.
Hello, all. On behalf of my Uncle Ward, I'd like to read his personal remembrance to his daughter, Lisa. The births of my three children have equally marked the most wonderful years of my life. But I knew somebody special came into our world when my daughter, Lisa, was born on December 8, 1993. There are many cliched father and daughter relationships in this world, but I know ours was unique. Of course, we had our many differences at times, and our relationship wasn't perfect, but I always felt that it was Lisa who taught me more about life than I could ever teach her. Whether it was the way I treated other people, situations I should have reworded, it was ultimately my daughter who corrected me to get my message across in a peaceful way. She always knew the exact words to say without compounding a difficult situation. At such a young age, she was a great teacher. Her birth brought a lot of positivity, peace, smiles, and laughter into our world. Our relationship was, in many ways, like a strong friendship. She was my adventure buddy. Whether it was hiking the high mountains to sit on the ledge of Half Dome, jumping off the highest sea cliffs in Maui, snowboarding off the steep runs of Mammoth, fishing all day in a boat at Lake Crowley, or cheering side by side at Dodger Stadium. We did these things together, as best buddies would do. To be honest, I'm not sure she really loved doing these things, or she loved doing them with me, or she did them because I love these activities. Either way, she made me believe that I was so special to have a daughter so interested in the same things that I was. That will always mean so much to me. My favorite memory with Lisa was in Mammoth, a place she always loved to visit. I remember it like yesterday. Lisa was about 8 years old, and we were taking a short hike along Mammoth Creek. As an adventurer, she was always intrigued by the stream and asked me if there were any fish in there. I answered nonchalantly, "Sure there is," and that's all she needed to hear. We didn't have any fishing gear, but that didn't stop her from finding a stick, an old fishing line, and an old hook tangled in the trees, and some salmon eggs off the ground for bait. I remember laughing at her impractical attempt to fish, but also admiring her spirit and enthusiasm. I remember smiling at her serious efforts as she kept dipping the line into the shallow stream. Dipping, dropping, and moving. Dipping, dropping, and moving. The rhythm was finally interrupted when I heard her scream, "Daddy, I got one!" Her face was gleaming. Her perfect smile spread from ear to ear, and she was jumping up and down. Perseverance, determination, positivity, carefree. Lisa lived that. She always made the best out of any situation. She never gave up. I was proud of her that day as much as I am today. Lisa and I also enjoyed doing the simple things, such as sitting at the campfire in the Sierras. We loved looking up at the heavenly stars as the night got late, the air chillier, the campfire lower. The whole galaxy glittered above us. We both loved that peaceful moment. With all of us around the fire, looking up, she would always say, "Dad, did you see that shooting star?" I either have horrible eyes, which I do, or never looked in the right direction, but I never, ever saw the shooting star. I always missed seeing what she saw. And it wasn't just me. Alan and the boys would attest to Lisa being the only one seeing the shooting star, too. After a while, I would say, "Yeah, I think I saw that one," just wanting to be on her level. But to be honest, I never did see any of the shooting stars that she did. I'm coming clean here today. We were always so puzzled on why she was the only one who could see beyond the stars. But that was my daughter. She saw so much more beauty in this life than anyone else ever could. I will never forget our moments that we shared alone. Like when we snowboarded all day at Vail, when we were supposed to be on campus visiting Boulder. Or how she would quickly pop open my Coors Light right after my first hookup in the morning at Lake Crowley, saying, "It's my traditional victory beer." I will miss us craving those turkey sandwiches at Schatz on the way home from Mammoth. She was the only person I know that could keep pace with me in devouring the whole sandwich. I will miss our seventh inning stretches at Dodger Stadium, decked in our blue. I will miss our favorite little hidden places on Maui. I will miss those sing-alongs in the car to our favorite songs, though we both thought each other's voices were inferior to our own, when in reality, we were both horrible. Although we never got to climbing Machu Picchu next summer, I am certain that she is already there, waiting for me. I will miss exploring this planet with you. Beyond these shared memories and tangible adventures, I will mostly miss how you made me feel. You made me so proud to be your father because of the beautiful lady that you had become. I am not sure how or where you got those fine qualities that so many of your friends and family have expressed today, but you made us all feel so much happiness when we were around you. You taught us all how to become better people. You reminded us of how to make a positive difference in each other's lives. You made me the proudest father in the world. Next summer, on a clear August night in the Sierras, I will be sitting by that campfire as we so often did. I truly believe and know that I will finally see that star streaking across the sky. And I will know that it will be you smiling down on us, telling us that everything will be all right. Thank you.
With any loss of a loved one, we reflect upon the fond memories and think about what we have learned from those experiences. As a mother, I knew Lisa was a good girl, but I had no idea how many lives she has touched. I reflect back at my little Lisa and now realize truly the type of person she was. I want to share some of these memories with you. In preschool, it was open house. And the students had drawings of what they wanted to be when they grew up. Other girls had said, "I want to be a florist. I want to be a baker." Lisa's drawing was of a puppy. So I thought, my smart girl wants to be a vet because she loves animals. Reading more carefully, it said, "I want to be a puppy." I first laughed, then I thought, gee, maybe my daughter isn't very smart. Andy, her brother, put it well. He said, "Mom, she was like a puppy, always happy to see you, full of energy with unconditional love." I think she knew she was a puppy. When she was in kindergarten, during my parent-teacher conference, her teacher said, "Lisa is like the glue of the class. She makes sure everyone was okay and gets along with every student. Even at the young, tender age of 5, she was the glue and rock of the class, just like she was in our family." During middle school and high school, Lisa would constantly be on the phone or texting with friends, being the Lisa we all know as Miss Counselor, to the point she was exhausted emotionally and physically. I mean, poor Alan. By the time she saw him, he was like, she's crashed out, and he would just be sitting there. One day, I tried to give her my motherly advice and said, "Lisa, you have to be careful because you are just way too nice. People take advantage of people like you." I'm so glad she didn't take my advice because that was just her, caring and thinking about others. Of course, we had our moments during those awkward middle school years. Trust me, she wasn't always as sweet at home. But being the old soul with a calm disposition, we really had a good relationship. For example, when Ward and I would argue, actually fight, she would walk in our room as I'm yelling at the top of my lungs, and she would say in her calm and stern voice, "Mom, you know you can't always be right, and you need to calm down. Dad, you can't take Mom's words so literally because she has no filter. She doesn't mean what she says." And she just turn around and walk out. Ward and I would just look at each other dumbfounded. We would stop fighting and thought, she was absolutely right. As Ward mentioned, often our roles were switched. At UC Davis, Lisa loved playing Ultimate Frisbee, and we would go watch her play. I remember distinctly in her freshman year, we went up to watch a tournament, and Lisa dropped a pass in the end zone. Ward looked at me and said, she has your genes, because a Nakamaru would have caught that. I know the Nakamaru's all here could relate. It's a Nakamaru thing, trust me. I couldn't argue with him there. When we saw her a game recently, she had improved tremendously. Lisa wasn't the best athlete out there. Like you said, she was very clumsy. She fell. That's why I had to laugh, because I can just see her falling in the snow, rolling, and just, you know, same thing. Just very clumsy. But she worked hard to improve, always cheering her team on. On a recent trip to Africa, the driver asked each of us, what is your favorite animal? I said, cheetah. They are the fastest land animal, beautiful and skinny like me. Lisa said, hyena. We all looked at her and said, hyena? Why? They're so ugly and they're scavengers. She replied with her one eyebrow up, which she often did when she wanted to make a point. She'll say, hyenas have an important role in the ecosystem. They are perceived as bad. Disney kind of gave them a bad rap, but they are needed. It's the circle of life, Mom. She rooted for the underdog. She didn't judge animals nor people because she knew there is good in everyone, animals included. She also laughed like one too. In closing, these are the things I learned from you, Lisa Tantan. That's what we used to call her when she was little. Be patient and learn to listen to others without interrupting, both not my strengths. Be kind and compassionate to all living things, including the environment. Don't judge a book by its cover, and remember that not everyone is like me. Filter, Mom, filter. Be accountable for bad behavior. Stop making excuses and make changes for the better. Do the best you can with a positive attitude, and you can overcome any difficult situation. Don't take any minute for granted. Give lots of hugs, spend time with your loved ones, and follow your passion. Smile, appreciate life, and give thanks every day, not only during Thanksgiving, but every day. Studies have shown, sorry honey, I know you hated it when I said this phrase, that smiling and appreciative people tend to be happy people. No wonder you were so happy. Spread your love, as love truly can conquer all. Although your time here was short, I was blessed to have you as a daughter. Some have given Dad and I credit for who you were, but I know that everyone that you have crossed paths with made you that loving person we all knew. With your passing, we have gained a huge ohana, and I know with their support and prayers, we are going to be okay. You will always be in our hearts, and thank you for teaching me so much. I promise that I will do my best to live like Lisa until we meet again. Oh, and one more thing. She hated that when I said that. Oh, okay, and one more thing. Don't worry, we'll take care of Rosie. And I'm sure you'll be happy with your celebration of life, because your brothers and Alan and Auntie Flo and many, many others work so hard to make it the best party you've ever had. Please continue to look after us. I know you will. And we love you and you miss you, but we'll be okay. Thank you.
My name is Julia, and I am Lisa's favorite aunt. Mind you, she never told me that I'm her favorite aunt, but that is how she always made me feel. And I know that that's how she made a lot of you feel as well. Favorite parent, favorite brothers, favorite grandparents, favorite uncle, favorite aunt, favorite cousins. You were all her best friends, and that's how she made you all feel. My niece, Lisa, that was how she was capable, making you feel that she was the most important person in her life. And as I spent a lot of time, as all of you have, reading a lot of tributes that are written on her Facebook page, I cannot notice that there's always a recurring theme that she always made time for us, her fabulous humor, her silliness, and I'm afraid I didn't see a whole lot of her dance moves, but I'll take your word for it. Her kindness and her beautiful smile, that beautiful smile. Since her passing, a lot of you have been asking the family what you could do to keep her memory alive. And as you know, the family has established a scholarship on her behalf at South High, and a lot of information is available. So I hope that you would make that donation, and that is established for a student that best demonstrates living like Lisa. There is also a special fund established at Herbalife Family Foundation under her name, and I hope because she loved children so much, and that is a nonprofit organization set up to help the children improve their lives, I hope that you would also look into that. And in several weeks, we will change the Facebook page in loving memory of Lisa Sayaka Nakamaru to change to Live Like Lisa page. And we're hoping that whenever you conduct a random act of kindness, do something that you feel like you live like Lisa, please share that with us on that page and hashtag it in this age of social media, Live Like Lisa. It might be tomorrow that you did that. It might be next week. It might be a year from now. But we hope to keep her memory to live like Lisa, and I hope that you will share that with us. Thank you very much.
Take my hand, hold it tight. sing a song.
This is live better than Animal Planet.
You know, I had an amazing time last week with the family as you guys came in and met with us. Just an amazing time sitting with them and learning about the life of Lisa. As difficult as a time as it has been with all the grieving and the mourning, it was amazing as we sat in that room and as each family member shared and as Alan would also share stories about Lisa, you would just see their face just light up. And as they lit up sharing about Lisa, I would light up as well. Just learning about her and hearing all the reflections that her best friends have shared and her family members have shared. It's no wonder that the theme for today's tribute and the memory of Lisa's life is Live Like Lisa. It's totally obvious to me why it is so important for us to live like Lisa. In fact, I think Lisa lived such a full life. She lived it to the fullest that if Lisa were to stand here today and speak out to you guys, I think she would say, hey guys, live like me. Live like me. And I don't think that would be in an arrogant way, but very humbly, I think she would want every single person she loves and cares about to live life to the fullest, to experience the thrill and the exhilaration of this life that we have. You know, as I was growing up, my father would always tell me, he would say, your friends have a lot to offer you. They can offer you many things, but take the good things and apply it to your life. And hearing from all the friends and family today, there's so many things from Lisa's life that I believe we can take with us and apply to our lives. But there's two things that I think really stuck out to me as a theme. I just want to share those with you guys today as an encouragement for us to take that with us and apply it to our lives. Here's the first thing that really stuck out to me about Lisa's life was that Lisa loved putting people first. I think everybody would agree, she always put people first. Very simple girl, didn't spend a lot on herself. They told me that she loved to shop at Marshall's, and that was good for her, that was fine for her, but when it came to spending on her brothers or family members, she went over and beyond. She had no problem shelling out that extra cash she would never spend on herself in order to provide the best for her brothers, or even for her dog Rosie. $80 boots for her dog Rosie was not a problem for her. And when I hear that about Lisa, you know, as a pastor, that's something we teach our church. We teach the people in our church, hey, listen, put other people first. Lay your life aside, and we try to teach people that week after week, put yourself aside, because that's something Jesus taught us. In John chapter 15, verse 13, Jesus, from his own very own mouth, he said this, greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. He was saying there is no greater demonstration of love than to put yourself aside for the interests and for the best of your friends. And that's how Lisa lived. That's what she was all about. And I look at her life and I hear these descriptions and I think, man, she lived like Jesus. She lived a Christ-like life in many respects. She reflected one of the most outstanding characteristics of Jesus. And so I challenge you guys, live like Lisa. Put yourself aside and put other people first. The second thing that really sticks out to me about her life, as I've heard many people share, is she loved outdoor adventures. Right, she loved the outdoors, whether it was camping in the wide open or snowboarding through the mountains with her brothers. She loved the outdoors. And Lisa loved adventure, whether it was jumping out of the airplane with Alan, thousands of feet in the sky, or whatever it may have been, traveling the world, visiting as many countries as she could. Her goal was to visit every continent on this planet. She loved adventures. And I believe that she took the best of both of those worlds, and she loved outdoor adventures. I believe outdoor adventures were the very things that made her thrive. It gave her that experience of the fullness and the thrill of life. It filled her tank, giving her that energy to go, 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 and experience life to the fullest. And so it was no wonder that that day she was drawn to the river. She was drawn to that river. And as the family went together to visit that very site, it started pouring that day. That morning just started pouring rain, and it made it very difficult to get to that very spot. And yet, as a family, they decided, no, we're going to go. Rain or shine, we're going to go to that river. And as they went, and as they started making that trek, they told us the rain was like tears falling from the skies. But as we made our way there, all of a sudden it stopped and the clouds parted, and it's like the sky became clear. It's like the sun shone through the sky, and it was the most beautiful and tranquil scene as they stood there at that river. The river, they said, was so peaceful that even as the family threw in flowers as a tribute to Lisa, it's like they didn't even want to go anywhere. The flowers just stayed right where they threw it, so still and so peaceful. And I love that picture of this river that was once a rushing current. That day, as the family stood there, it was a very peaceful river, very still, very calm. And I love that picture because the Bible paints a picture that we can have peace like a river. That if we would live for our Creator, if we would live for God, then we can experience a peace in our soul that's like that river that you stood before that day. In fact, not only can we experience peace like a river in our souls here in this lifetime and on this earth, I love the picture of the river that we can experience forever. In Revelation 22, this is the last passage of the Bible, the very last passage. It gives us a picture of heaven. And there it says, "The angel showed me the river of the water of life, as clear as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and from the throne of Jesus Christ, down the middle of the great street of the city. And on each side of the river stood the tree of life. And the leaves of that tree are for the healing of the people. No longer will there be any curse." Revelation tells us there in heaven, God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no mourning. There will be no more death. There will be no more crying. And there will be no more pain. I believe we can all make it a point from this day on to live like Lisa. We can learn to put other people first before ourselves. We can live to experience the beautiful adventure that this life has to offer us. But the good news is that we can live forever like Lisa. I believe that Lisa would want everything that was shared about her life here on this stage and from this point on to be the most meaningful things that people have to offer, the most honest and sincere things that people can offer. And this is the most meaningful thing I can say looking at Lisa's life. That just like Lisa lived this Jesus-like life here on earth, in heaven, the Bible tells us we can be totally like that, totally like Jesus, because we will see him face to face. And just like Lisa went to the river for adventure and experienced the thrill of life, in heaven, we will experience the everlasting thrill and adventure of that peaceful river that gives us life and life eternal. The Bible tells us this: God so loved every single person. He loved the world just like Lisa. He loved Lisa so much that he gave his one and only son, Jesus, to die on the cross for our sins. That whoever believes in him, we will have that life eternally. We will live eternally. And so I pray that as we leave this place, we would continue to remember her, continue to honor her. We would live like Lisa. And even more, I pray that we would live forever like Lisa. That we would seek out our God, our Creator. We would seek and believe and accept Jesus and experience the absolute fullness of life, just like Lisa would want for us. Amen. Amen. Can I pray with this? Would you join me in a word of prayer? Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that we can come here and be reminded again and again and again of the beautiful life that you have given Lisa. And I thank you so much that she did not waste a moment of it. She lived it to the fullest. She lived it on the edge. And she brought everybody along with her. Lord, it's evident that her impact will not quickly fade. It's going to live with us forever. But God, I pray that it would go beyond this lifetime here on this earth. I pray that you would help us to really seek to live forever like Lisa, to take the qualities that she demonstrated and displayed, and that we would love and desire to experience that eternally. I pray that you would help us to know you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you so much for your gift of eternal life, that it doesn't have to end here, that we can keep on living. Lord, we pray that you would reach down into our hearts and that you would fill us with the greatest gift ever, the gift of salvation, the gift of eternal life. So, Lord, we thank you, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
There's a verse in Jack Johnson's song, Angel, that reminds me of my niece, Lisa. She'll give you presents with her presence alone. Many of us have memories today that will bring both tears and smiles to our faces. Lisa was so special that there are guests here from Japan and all over the States. On behalf of the Nakamaru and Tanaka families, we'd like to thank you for your love and acts of kindness shown in honoring our angel, Lisa. Following the service, the ushers will direct those who would like to come up and give their final goodbye to Lisa. After, please join the family for food and refreshments in the cafe area where you can give your condolences to the family and talk story. I leave you with this last video.
Open up your eyes and see like me. Open up the plants, damn, you're free. Look into your heart and you'll find love, 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 love. Listen to the music of the moment, people dance and sing. We're just one big family, and it's our God's particular right to be love, 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 love. So I won't hesitate no more, no more, it cannot wait. I'm sure there's no need to complicate. Our time is short, this is our fate. I'm yours.
Wow, what a beautiful person Lisa was. Currently at this time, we are going to pay our final tributes to Lisa. But before doing so, the family is going to take a moment to pay their final tributes, and then they will head outside to the reception area where they are more than welcome, each and every one of you, to take a moment to say hello and share your condolences. But at this time, I know this is a tough day. I know this loss is so devastating and so heartbreaking. And so I know myself and Pastor Greg are available to any and every one of you if you need some help, some prayers, any kind of encouragement. I'll also have a handout ready and available for you if you're seeking more counseling and some help in your time of grief and mourning. But at this time, if you would just please remain seated, the ushers will come by and dismiss you one by one to either pay your final tributes, or if you would like, you can make your way out to the reception area and greet the family. But until that point, please, at this time, remain seated and let the ushers instruct you moving forward. Thank you.